Thank you very much for joining us here today to celebrate the life of our dear colleague, teacher, and friend, John Barsky. My name is Christina Barwitzky, and I was one of Mr. Barsky's students. He was my grade 9 math teacher when I started here at SGR in 1982. I currently live at his school, and it's a tremendous honor for us to hold this service at SGR today. John spent close to 30 years teaching at SGR and shared a meal and wonderful conversation with many in his dining hall. It is also in his dining hall that he is honored as Educator Emeritus on the wall behind him. His name will forever be on his walls, overseeing generations of students who will never have had benefit of his teaching and friendship. But for those of us who did and come back to school, will glance upon his name with great fondness and memories. It is also in this dining hall that only a few months ago, during our homecoming weekend, that John enjoyed his last homecoming dinner with us. It was September 22nd. Because it was his birthday that day, it must have been overwhelming for him when everyone in attendance said happy birthday. It was a very special moment, and I'm so glad that happened. John's students and friends have been all over the world. We've had many people reach out to us wanting to be a part of the celebration. These beautiful flowers came from the class of 1984. Many of them live in Toronto, and they shared special messages, which I will read with you. To all of the family, friends, colleagues, and students who will miss John as much as we do, remember to take care of each other, just as John did for us. We will miss you, sir. And these are from Papa, Stephen, Godfrey, Nancy, Faye, Sandy, and Lauren. Dear Mr. Barsky, you inspired, entertained, and cared for us every math class of middle and upper school. Apart from that blip in grade 9, but you got us back and never let us go. We will miss our favorite teacher, and we will never forget you. We are recording this service today. We're not live streaming, but it will be available for everyone. And what's important is that it will be available for John's sister, Patricia. She lives in Victoria and is not able to join us. Patricia, I hope you realize by all of us who are here in attendance today and from the beautiful tributes that have been posted on John's obituary and from the messages that will be coming your way, your brother is deeply respected and loved. To our guests, we have left a mint card on your chair, and you probably thought Mr. Barsky left one final math problem for him to solve, sadly no. We hope that you will take the time to let Patricia know what her brother meant to you. You are welcome to leave your card with us. There will be a basket as you exit. And if you need a little bit of extra time, you can send your message to us at school, and we'll make sure she receives that. It is now time for others to speak about John, and I am pleased to welcome his dear friend, Mark Duncan, to the podium.
Thank you, Christina. Each of us carries a ledger, and in it are two columns, what we have given and what we have taken. I don't think there's any doubt that the ledger of the man on today has a number. I don't think there's any doubt that the ledger of the man on today has a number in any column such as you can see in column irrelevant. How did he give? In these ways. He gave through his unparalleled ability to teach. In fact, he was very probably the greatest teacher in the school's history. Only someone who had never been taught by or worked with John could think otherwise. John's students adored him, not just for his ability to get the very best out of them in the process of garnering victory after victory in national and provincial math contests, but for his quick wit, kindness, and self-effacement. I often wonder, how can such an accomplished man be so humble? Yet he was always aiming the spotlight on his students and never on himself. He taught in an informal way as well. He was a great listener, but also a great talker, able to expound on a vast variety of subjects, many of them highly esoteric. He delighted in the eccentricities of the English language, and it was impossible not to be humbled by his extraordinary knowledge of world culture. John loved literature, especially poetry, and was able to recite long passages of his favorite poets from memory. As I used to tell him, it would be impossible for me to do his job, but certainly possible for him to do mine. He gave through his mentorship, not just to teach us in the math department, but for all of those lucky enough to fall under his influence. Happily, I was a member of that group. Someone once said that great teachers are like candles. They consume themselves in order to light the way for others. They make it plain that temporary failure on the road to success is a bruise, not a tattoo. He gave through his delightful personality. He was full of fun, loved jokes, with the notable exception of risque ones. I don't think that type can work with this idea of being a gentleman. A remarkable fact is that in the 45 years I knew him, I never once heard him voice a four-letter word. His humor was like that of a less caustic Oscar Wilde, ironic but rarely acidic. Speaking of Oscar Wilde, he once drew my attention to one of his favorite Wildean quotations. Quote, "Bachelors should be heavily taxed. It is not fair that some men should be happier than others." The example of the gentlemanly wit that I will always remember occurred when my daughter was in her infancy. When she was very young, we would go over to John's on a regular basis. Upon entering, she would say, "Hi, John Carson." She thought it was all in the room. Before commencing her ritual of putting on his shoes and happily shuffling around the room. After that, she would get up on his lap, and he would read her Mother Goose. One day, he came to a verse that two of them had not yet read. He read like this: "From Wilton Hall to this 15 miles, from Walton to Wilton to 15 miles, from Wilton to Walton, from Walton to Wilton, from Wilton to Walton to 15 miles." After reading her this voice, he adopted the greatest of expressions and said to my three-year-old, "Zoe, if the distance from Wilton to Walton is 15 miles, and the distance from Walton to Wilton is 15 miles, then the distance from Wilton to Walton, and then from Walton to Wilton, finally from Wilton to Walton, is actually 45 miles." Thus was born her love of math. He gave through his kindness. I'm sure you'll agree with Mark Twain that kindness is the language which the deaf can hear and the blind can see. That was the language John spoke. As you all know, happiness follows closely upon the kind of words, and the amount of which kind of act bears no relation to its effect. About a week before he passed away, I was over at John's for coffee. At that point, he had been admitted to the ER twice in the past week. He was weak and exhausted. But that didn't impede him from being who he always was. After slicing off a piece of blueberry pie for me, he said, "I'll heat it up for you. It will be so much nicer." There was something quintessentially John about that simple gesture. I will never forget. He gave through his writing. This is one of John's gifts that has flown too much under the radar, so allow me to draw to your attention. John was a writer of lovely short stories, reminiscences, and essays, both personal and argumentative. In the past year, he published his wonderful book, 50 Years in the Classroom, What I Learned There. I cannot recommend it too highly. To those who have heard of this book, but have not yet purchased it, I have a simple question. Whatever is the matter with you? It is a treasure trove, of school memories, both as a student and as a teacher, character portraits, and educational theory. His website, johnlarson.ca, has more on the same than Martin himself. Please give it a look. Finally, he gave through what is perhaps the greatest love of all, the love of friendship. I will not expand on what John's friendship meant to me, since that is a very private matter, and it would be presumptuous of me to conjecture what it meant for others. But I think that quoting a few sentences from one of his favorite books might strike a chord in those gathered here today. Here is that great philosopher, Anita Guru, speaking to his friend. If you live to be 100, I will tell you to be 100 miles from my day, so I never have to live without you. Any day spent with you is my favorite day. So, today is my new favorite day. If the friend you were talking to doesn't appear to be listening, be patient. It may simply be that he has a small piece of fluff in his ear. How lucky we are to have something that makes saying goodbye so hard. I'm going to finish today by giving John the last word, a short personal essay he wrote for the Globe and Mail in 2016 when he was 71. As I read it, I trust it will be easy for you to hear the voice and personality of the much loved man if you're married today. In John's own words, I clearly remember the day when I left home to seek adventure. I was 7 years old at the time. The year was 1953, and the place was a small Saskatchewan village located in the Tidewell Valley. Perhaps I was inspired by Tom Sawyer, whose adventures were parceled out to me at that time. One chapter and then read by the library. Perhaps my daughter, Chung, gave me the idea. He was my constant companion, always there to protect me, unless, of course, there was a rabbit he chased. I found my mother in the kitchen serving tomatoes. I'm going to walk down the dirt road I told her to look for adventure. The reply was predictable: make sure you're back in time for supper. In those distant days, at least in rural areas, unleashed children and dogs were roaming freely. I left by the back door. As I passed the garage, I could hear the whine of an electric saw. Rural electrification had recently come to us, and my father, with his new electric tools, was madly at work making wooden lawn chairs. The road that passed our house was truly a dirt road. Grass grew between two ribbons of hard packed earth. I headed out of town. Railway tracks were on one side and a pasture was on the other. Beyond the pasture was a line of hills marking the northern edge of the valley. Chubby dashed ahead. The ditch between the road and the pasture was completely dry, filled with foxtails, goldenrod, plants with nasty burrs, and prickly wild rose bushes past the season for blooming. Chummy plowed through the tangle, confident that I would later pick off the burrs he required and squeeze into the fence. The pasture, the home of rabbits and gophers. I knew I would not see it for a while. I took a detour through the neighbor's yard to see their two white pigs. Back on the road, past the stand of trees, I came to a farmer's dug filled with water and securely fenced in. I stood for a while looking at the fence, hoping to see some turtles, but none appeared. I moved on. Home seemed very far away. Eventually, I sat down on some freshly cut grass at the edge of the weather. The smell of late summer was in the air, and my thoughts turned to school, which had so far not been a happy experience. I was socially awkward, unsure of myself, and still didn't speak clearly. I could not pronounce the letters R and J and avoid the words that contained them. Would that be a bit awkward when anyone asked me my name, since it contained I usually struggle with that saying, I don't know. I stretched out on the grass, closed my eyes, soothed by the sound of the grasshoppers and the sound and the song of the waters. A babysitter had recently taught me how to imitate another one. Use a squeaky voice, she said, and see very quickly, I was hearing you murmur. Suddenly, Charlie was back, nuzzling me, and I sat up. A strange sense of anxiety came over me. What were Mom and Dad doing while I was away? Perhaps this was 2953, not 1853. And they were experimental scientists, pretending to be my parents, doing the kinds of things parents did in 1953, so that they could study me to learn more about the children of the distant past. Oh, he's gone for a while, I imagine him saying as soon as I was out of sight. Now we can take a break from those miserable tomatoes and those skewed lawn chairs. Even worse, suppose that Mom and Dad belonged to a team of scientists who did shift work. When I got back, they'd be gone, and new people would have taken their place, training their roles and dress so that I would not know the difference. Worst of all, suppose the experiment was called off. I would get back, but the house and garage would be gone. Instead, knee-high grass would gently ripple and move. Returning home seemed very urgent. I dashed past the dugout, past the small stand of trees. Suddenly, home was in sight. I had not gone that far after all. As I passed the garage, I could smell fresh paint and knew that the latest batch of lawn chairs was almost finished. In the kitchen, 7 pints of preserved tomatoes stood on the counter. And the hiss and the pressure cooker told me he won't be coming. My mother looked exactly the same. Had there been a shift change? There's no way to know for sure, but I decided it was best to abandon that fence. Did you have an adventure? My mother asked. My vocabulary lacked the words to explain that the experience had been both scary and memorable. I recently visited that village. For the first time in more than half a century, almost everything had changed. The dirt road was now gravel. The house and the garage were gone. Knee-high grass, gently running the road, just beside the initiative, many years ago. Only the distant hills seemed the same. And the sound. Excuse me, my friend, I love you.
Thank you, Mark. Many of you are probably wondering why reading the Dr. Seuss novel would make its way into this program. This comes from conversations with Murray and Patricia Culp. Murray Culp has known John since the university days, and just this morning I learned that it was day 2 of university in chemistry class. When Murray sat at the very top row, there were 2 men students, and one day they went down to the front row where he met John. They became loyal friends. John was a member of their family and was at their holiday dinners and special events and watched the cult children grow up. I learned that John had act out, I'm being swallowed by a boa constrictor, to the children on any of those occasions, and I suspect maybe Zoe received that as well. And also, he would recite by memory Dr. Seuss's Horton Hatch's The Egg. It is the latter that we are presenting today. To read Horton Hatch's The Egg, I am pleased to welcome another of Mr. Marcy's students, Doc Martin.
When I first heard that John had committed to memory Dr. Seuss stories and recited them from the top of his head to children, I thought, of course he did. Of course he did. That makes perfect sense. But when I was asked to read this today, I immediately said yes. I'm thankful that I could have participated in this, but also very thankful that it wasn't a schlock. learning and reminded today that John was drawn to things that brought him joy and made him joyful. I went to school here in the '80s, and I was taught by giants. Of the elephants in that room that I was learning. They did not give me the answers, they taught me how to think. So I will not do anything so crass to tell you what I think this means. Rather, I would ask you to listen, enjoy, and decide for yourself why John was brought to this story, to commit to memory, and to share it with you. These I did not have in the 80s. There we go. Word and Hash the Egg by Dr. Susan. Side lazy. A lazy bird, actually an egg. I'm tired and I'm bored and I have kinks in my leg from sitting, just sitting here day after day. It's work. How I hate it. I'd much rather play. I'd take a vacation, fly off for a rest. If I could find someone to stay on the nest, if I could find someone, I'd fly away free. Then Horton, the elephant, passed by the tree. Hello, cried the lazy bird, smiling her best. You've nothing to do, and I too need a rest. Would you like to sit on the egg in my nest? The elephant laughed. Oh, if all the silly things I had, feathers, and I had wings, me on your egg, why, that doesn't make sense. Your egg is so small, man, and I'm so immense. Tut, tut, answered Maisie. I know you're not small, but I'm sure you can do it. No trouble at all. Just sit on it softly. You're gentle and kind. Come, be a good fellow. I know you won't mind. I can't, said the elephant. Please, begged the bird. I won't be gone long, sir. I'll give you my word. I'll hurry right back. Why, I'll never be missed. Very well, said the elephant, since you insist. You want a vacation? Go fly off and take it. I'll sit on your egg and I'll try not to break it. I'll stay and be faithful. I mean what I say. Doo, sang out Maisie, and she fluttered away. The first thing to do, muttered Horton, let's see. The first thing to do is to prop up this tree and make it much stronger. That has to be done before I go, and I must wait a time. Then carefully, tenderly, gently, he crept up the trunk to the nest where the little egg slept. Then Horton the elephant smiled. Now that's that. And he sat, and he sat, and he sat, and he sat. And he sat all that day, and he kept the egg warm, and he sat all that night through a terrible storm. It poured, and it lightened, it thundered, and it rumbled. This isn't much fun, the poor elephant grumbled. I wish you'd come back, because I'm cold and I'm wet. I hope that Maisie Bird doesn't forget. But Maisie, by this time, was far beyond reach, enjoying the sunshine, way off in Palm Beach, and having such fun, such a wonderful rest, decided she'd never go back to the nest. So Horton kept sitting there day after day, and soon it was autumn. The leaves blew away, and then came the winter, the snow, and the sleet, and icicles hung from his trunk at his feet. But Horton kept sitting, and said with his knees, I'll stay on this egg, and I won't let it freeze. I meant what I said, and I said what I meant, and elephants faithful 100%. So poor Horton sat there the whole winter through, and then came the springtime with troubles anew. His friends gathered round and shouted at me. Look, Horton the elephant's up in a tree, they taunted. They teased him. They yelled. How absurd! Old Horton the elephant thinks he's a bird. They laughed, they laughed, then they all ran away. And Horton was lonely. He wanted to play. But he sat on the egg and continued to say, I meant what I said, and I said what I meant. And elephants faithful 100%. No matter what happens, this egg must be tended. But poor Horton's troubles were far from end. For while Horton sat there, so faithful, so kind, three hunters came sneaking up softly behind. He heard the man's footsteps. He turned with a start. Three rifles were aiming, right straight in his heart. Did he run? He did not. Horton stayed on that nest. He held his head high and threw out his chest. And he looked at the huntress as much as to say, shoot if you must, but I won't run away. I meant what I said what I meant. An elephant's faithful, 100%. But the men didn't shoot. Much to Horton's surprise, they brought their three guns. They stared with wide eyes. Look, they all shouted. Can such a thing be? An elephant sitting on top of a tree? It's strange. It's amazing. It's wonderful. New. Don't shoot them. We'll catch him. That's just what we'll do. Let's take him alive. Why, he's terribly funny. We'll sell him back home to a circus for money. And the first thing he knew, they had built a big wagon with ropes on the front for the pullers to drive it. They dug up his tree and they put it inside. Horton was so sad that he practically cried. We're off, the men shouted. And off they all went, with Horton unhappy, 100%. Up out of the jungle, up into the sky, up over the mountains 10,000 feet high, then down, down the mountains, down to the sea, went the cart with the elephants, egg, nest, and tree. Then out on the wagon and onto the ship and over the ocean, no, a trip, rolling and tossing and splashing the spray, and Horton said, day after day after day, I meant what I said and I said what I meant. But old wife seasick, 100%. After bobbing around for 2 weeks like a cork, they landed at last in the town of New York. All ashore, the men shouted, and down the lurch went Horton the elephant, still on his perch, tied onto a board that could just scarcely hold him. Bump, where he landed. Then the men sold him. Sold to a circus that week after week, they showed him to people at 10 cents a week. They took him to Boston, to Kalamazoo, Chicago, Weehawken, and Washington, too, to Dayton, Ohio, St. Paul, Minnesota, to Wichita, Kansas, to Drake, North Dakota. And everywhere, thousands of folks flocked to see and laughed at the elephants out in the tree. Poor Horton, who staggered the farther he went. But he said as he sat in the hot, noisy tent, I meant what I said, and I said what I meant, and an elephant's faithful, but 100%. Then one day, the circus show happens to reach a town way down south, not so far from Long Beach, and dawdling up a long way up in the sky, who of all people should chance to fly by with that good-for-nothing bird, runaway Maisie, still on vacation and still just as lazy. And spying the flags and the tents just below, she sang out, what fun! Why, I think I'll go to the show. And she swooped from the clouds through an open tent door. Good gracious, gasped Maisie. I've seen you before. Poor Horton looked up with his face white as chalk, and he started to say, but before he could talk, there rang out the noisiest ear-splitting squeaks from the egg that had sat for 51 weeks. A thumping, a bumping, a wild, alive scratching. My egg, shouted Horton. My egg, why, it's hatching. But it's mine, screamed the bird when she heard that egg crack. The work was all done now. She wanted it back. It's my egg, she sputtered. You stole it from me. Get off of my nest and get off of my tree. Poor Horton backed down with a sad, heavy heart. But at that very instant, the egg burst apart, and out of the pieces of red and white shell from the egg that had sat on so long and so well, Horton the elephant saw something whiz. It had ears and a tail and a trunk just like his. And the people came shouting, what's all this about? They looked, they stared, their eyes popping out. Then they cheered and they cheered and they cheered more and more. They'd never seen anything like it before. Goodness, gracious, they shouted, my word, it's something brand new. It's an elephant bird. And it should be. It should be. It should be like that, because Horton was faithful. He sat, and meant what he said, and he said what he meant, and they sent him home happy, 100%. Thank you, John.
Thank you, John. Throughout John's teaching career, which started in Stowe Lake and Morton Bell and in Chicago, he He taught thousands of students to be connected with so many, and I know he'd be thrilled by the students who are here today and his lifelong friends, you know, from serving days and doing the city. So thank you, all of you. Sharing one of his stories is SGR student, alumnus from the class of 2004, Will Guest.
So I have the great privilege of being one of Mr. Barsky's last students. In fact, I think formally he retired in 2003 and returned on a contract to see us through, to see us through to our graduation. I have, of course, spent a lot of time reflecting on what he meant to me. And I think we are all so lucky that he committed pen to paper and expressed this in his book. The idea that resonates with me is what he calls the magic in the classroom. And as the phrase implies, it's a very difficult thing to pin down. As I thought about it, I think there were three ingredients to Mr. Barsky's magic. As he put in the book, a teacher has to be both the guy on the side and the stage on stage. Mr. Barsky excelled at both. We all, of course, remember his recitation of Orson Welles' name. We, I'm sure, all remember his remarkable memory game, where he would ask for 25 objects in random, commit them to memory, and then be able to recite them back in specified order. We know his immaculate circle drawing abilities, which are unrivaled to this day. So there's an element of performance art in what he did. And that, of course, is sort of the stage-on-stage aspect. But it was the guy on the side role in which Mr. Barsky really excelled. In a class of 25 or so students, he gave each one individual attention. Even as people pursued the curriculum and their learning at their own pace, he managed to tailor his lessons and his instruction to everyone in that class. The second thing that struck me as very, very unique about his ability in the classroom was the motivation that he conferred on his students. And this was done in, as is so typical of him, a quiet and gentle way. I remember when I was just starting in grade 8, he explained that, you know, we will follow a set curriculum, we have the textbooks, but every year there are a few students who decide to sort of quietly work ahead. And, you know, they may get through the curriculum faster than others, and then they can go on and they may be able to take courses at the university. And so as it was explained to me, you know, there's an orange book, and then there's a red book, and then there's a green book, and then there's a park book, and then you can take university courses. The sheer linearity of that path was, as a graduate student was just bearing to go, very powerful. Furthermore, when I knew him, he had benefited, of course, of decades of students preceding him, preceding us, and he would tell us about their exploits and accomplishments. And so there are names of his former students, many of whom might have never met, Bill Weston, Kathleen Dean, Donnie Chung, Ian Luke. And he would tell us about what these people had accomplished. And that was something that showed us what was possible, that, you know, we applied ourselves, that we could achieve similar heights. And then I think the last and most important aspect of it was the enthusiasm and imagination. This was embodied in the Tuesday problems. So that every Tuesday we would get a new set of 8 problems, which were math contest style problems. And the sheer delight in jumping into those problems and kind of getting through the first few, usually pretty quickly, and then you get to the 7th or 8th, and they'd be real thinkers and take them home. And he always emphasized the importance of read the sheet, think about it today, and then let your subconscious work on it. Your mind is going to be grinding away while you sleep. And so it could be either on Thursday or Monday night or Tuesday morning, the inspiration will start to get ahead of the problem. And that is a technique that I use to this day, and it's something that I always think of him as I use that approach. One memory of mine that stands out as a testament to the dedication we had to the students. When I was in grade 9, unfortunately, he had a heart attack, and so he had to step away from teaching. And this is cold in his place at that time. And at that point, I was, as I remember, learning to particular series. And I guess I wasn't getting the concept. And so he had sent me a test, and I didn't do very well with his questions. And I remember Mrs. Polk one day just sort of quietly giving me some sheets that Mr. Barsky had written for me. And it was 20 handwritten pages, a tutorial on Taylor Swift. I don't know if he did it in his hospital bed or if he was recuperating at home by that time, but what a remarkable level of dedication. Another story that I just had come to share with him a little bit later, when I was taking a Calculus 2 course at the university. And he, of course, instructed me through what I would go to the university to write the exams. And as we got to the final, he said, okay, well, we'll look up the exam timetable and decide if I figure out when you need to write the exam. And I remember looking it up, it's like, oh, distance education, Wednesday. That must be, yeah, I'm going to the university. And then the Friday evening preceding this, I got a panicked phone call from Mr. Barsky. He was actually over at the Polk's house, and their son Patrick was about to write the Calculus 2 exam. Turns out I had misread the schedule. I was actually in the regular session, and the exam was that very night. So I had 45 minutes to get myself to the university and write the final exam. But I had been planning on spending that weekend getting ready, studying, and being prepared for the following Wednesday. I remember going out there. I was pretty small at the time. I didn't have a student ID card. It's just some person sitting there who had never been to the engineering 2 building before. I just remember shaking the whole way through it, calm down about 45 minutes in. And it all worked out perfectly well in the end. And that's thanks to Mr. Barsky's dedication and preparation, so that even if I didn't have time to study, he made sure that I was ready several days before the actual event. So I could go on and on with more and more treasured experiences and memories that I have. I'm lucky that I was able to stay in touch with him. I moved away to Vancouver in 2007, but I find myself in Winnipeg 2 times a year. So before I would come, I would always send him an email and stop by his house and see how he was doing. I did my internship in Victoria, and so I was actually able to meet him out there for lunch once when he was visiting his sister in Victoria. I had the sad duty on learning his passing to inform my classmates. And I got a very touching email back from Michael Knowsky, my friend, who, thanks to Mr. Barsky, was inspired to become a mathematics professor. And he reminded me of a quote from the fourth chapter of Mr. Barsky's book that I think sums up his legacy better than anything that I could say. It's a quote by Sybil Stark. And if you don't mind, I just have to use what she wrote and what this, I think, conveys his legacy to be. However small our influence, however little of knowledge and wisdom we leave with our pupils, year by year and class by class, we give something of ourselves to the children we teach. We are a little bit of the mosaic of their lives, and through them, an imperceptible flex of color, we pass ourselves down through the generations and our environment. Our names are not emblazoned upon great books, nor carved on massive buildings, nor brushed on canvas. Our children forget our faces and our names, but within them carry part of us. We are the Imams and Mortals. Thank you, Mr. Barsky.
Thank you, Will. I'd also like to give anyone else who wishes to say a few words the opportunity to speak. I do have a microphone that I will bring to you, so if you do have something to say, please let me know and I will come your way.
My name is Pamela Waddell Clemens, and I grew up with John Barsky. He started in the city as a mom. We were friends for 67 years, and I have a cute story. He was a year above me in school, but being a small school, we shared a classroom. And he got his teacher, Mrs. McVicker, and she got to me because he was so clever. But he didn't always pay attention. He felt really interested, and they just tuned. One day she asked him a question in class. We didn't answer. So she said, "John, why did you not ask me? What are you doing?" He said, "I'm sorry, Mrs. McVicker, I'm reading the dictionary."
Hello, everybody. My name is Paul Liu. I am a fellow residence and students. I am the privilege of being taught by him for 5 years through my middle school and until graduation. If I get emotional, I'm going to please relate. I actually was attending to teach my visits, partly to reconnect with him, but also seeing if he might have an extra time and ability to give some tutoring to one of my daughters who was having some struggles in math. And this was a real small part to be able to let her privilege experiencing his amazing teaching, as well as to experience some of what wants to be in a classroom experience. As everybody who has been taught by John Dorsey and all his colleagues know, his approach to teaching was so much more than just instilling knowledge and taking that academic approach. It was so cool in how meaningful and helpful it was, because he made my own fun. And as someone has commented today, he also stimulated us to think and process. But his classes were very enjoyable on different levels. And one of them was he also allowed it to be a bit of a social event at appropriate times. So I remember one day as we were waiting for a class performance ceremony, and all the students arrived. One of my classmates who didn't have any problem with people in education from history class just decided to learn about springtime, the time when boys soft turned to girls in baseball, to which one of our female classmates quickly replied, "Yep, and you strangled it both." As I was laughing, I glanced over at John, and I think he might have broken the rhythm with the laugh that he was doing, as he's trying to stifle it a little so as to retain some professional demeanor. So I don't really have any particular stories to share from the classroom, but I would like to share just some thoughts that came after I graduated, because in my undergrad years, where some of my friends who were also classmates, we were all at U of L, and we stayed in contact with John, where we would spend some time with him, on Friday night stage, just going to his house to be together and share some good times. And up until then, of course, I only knew him as a teacher, whom I had great respect for and enjoyed the same time. But in a personal setting, I just got to learn how much more he was as a person. He had incredible intellect. His house was, into itself a library with his collection of books, which of course he read all of them. But he was such a friendly and humble man that we were just feeling so valuable in his place. And we kept on going back every now and then when this group of freely in a catering degree heard by myself. And it turned to a bit of a tradition where he would shared a bunch of stories about his penetration with us, bringing donuts, and he would crack open a beer. And we would just sit around and enjoy each other's company for a couple hours. So apart from just seeing what an incredible intellectual man he was, I also want to see exactly how humble and welcoming a person he was. And I'll always treasure those memories. When John was easily the best teacher I had ever had in my life. And I regret not taking the opportunity to aid him visits as I was attending in these last few months. So I guess I'll just say thank you, John. I will miss my friend.
I want to say that Gordon Bell serves in here.
So I'm Trevor Sprague, I'm with SGR from 1984 to 1990, and John was truly an outstanding teacher. I had him for 5 years from grade 12. In a high math class, and not surprisingly today, I'm a CPA at CA, and his love of mathematics really rubbed off on me. It had a lot of practical applications. You wouldn't think that when you were going through algebra, trigonometry, linear algebra, and calculus. But what it taught me, and what it taught so many others, is that how to manipulate numbers, how to use numbers to understand them, and what that allowed me to do in my day-to-day life when I was working was incredible. It just opened up so many doors, and for me, I can't be thankful enough for the years that he dedicated to my education and the excellence that he brought to the school and to his life and to the province as well. I know he was certainly a key advisor to the education department and other organizations within Winnipeg and Manitoba. An unbelievable mind and someone that truly made an impact on many, many people's lives.
I was glad to hear the school Gordon Bell passion. I never did it again that way, Gordon Bell. But one of the things that I remember finding out about Gordon Bell that I actually grew up in Edmonton and came to Winnipeg on television. Some of you will remember that was Reach for the Puck. And Gordon Bell, while John Horsley was at Gordon Bell, he was the coach for the Reach for the Puck team. And Gordon Bell was always the team that you had to struggle against the various competitors. And so that to me was an indicator of what a tremendous polymath John was, that he could. He wasn't locked up on mathematics. He was a man for all seasons, a true Renaissance man. And I hope Gordon Bell remembers some of his
thank you, everyone.
Crossing the bar.
company the more. I encourage that this is a favorite. Yes, sir? Crossing the Bar by Alfred Tennessee. Sunset, an evening star, and one clear call for me. And may there be no moaning of the bark when I put out to sea. But such a tide as moving seems asleep, too full for sounding foam. When that which drew from out the boundless deep turns again, home. Twilight, an evening bell, and after that, the dark. And may there be no sadness of farewell when I embark. For though from out our bourne of time and place, the flood may bear me far. I hope to see my pilot face to face when I cross the bar. In a few minutes, I invite you all to gather in the front hall, chapel hall, for refreshments. There will also be seating in Robinson listening all to your right. One of my earlier comments alluded to the fact that perhaps John had one last math problem for us all to solve. Well, back in the 90s, I'm looking at Margaret Green right now. John was a frequent guest on Math with Marty.
Yes.
Yes. Mark Green was one of John's students at Gordon Bell, and he had a show on BPW, which is Winnipeg's public television station. What you are about to see is one of John's favorite episodes. I hope you will be able to hear this from the 90s. You can find it on YouTube as well as on Mr. Marsby's website, johnmarsby.ca, that Mark mentioned earlier, which in itself is John's gift to us all. The episode is longer, but I am only showing the part where John is discussing the perfect and interesting numbers. At the conclusion of the video, when Marty's playing Chopin, you are welcome to make your way to Chapel Hall. So thank you again for joining us, and thank you, John, for bringing us together. Rest in peace, sir.
Okay, we got a guest on. Mr. Barsby's back with another one of his patented math topics. And I think John, you were on holidays before it started school year and just got back.
We're back for the beginning.
You've been back since September. You haven't been feeling all that hot since you came back.
Well, I'm fine now, Marty.
Well, it's nice to have you here. Where were you?
I was in China.
China, okay. And you ate too much Chinese food.
That must have been it.
Well, okay.
Yes.
Well, it's nice to have you back. Now get up there and do your job.
Okay.
Here's some chalk.
Okay. My topic today, if you can call it a topic, is
that's not much
a brush. This is a wooden block, Marty.
Useless.
What do you use that for?
That's useless to you. Get rid of that stuff.
My topic today, if you can call it a topic, is simply interesting numbers. Now, before I get launched into anything about interesting numbers, I'll tell you a little story of, this has got to be about 10 years ago now, maybe not quite that long. But I had a grade 10 class at St. John's Ravenscourt, but it was a very good group. And one time, on the first of the month, I think it was February, I went in and wrote the date on the blackboard, and I had the 1, of course, February 1. And I looked at it, and I launched into this description of all the properties of 1 that made it a special number, properties of multiplication and so on, and the fact that it has fewer divisors than any other number, and therefore it's neither prime nor composite, and forgot all about it. But the next day, and I can still see that class in front of me, I know exactly who was in it. Perhaps some of your Math with Marty fans were in it, people like Kava Sojania and Sandy Dick and Karen Mehta, and maybe some of them are watching tonight. Anyway, Kava, who sat near the back, said the next day, "Tell us about the number 2. So there I was on the spot, but of course 2 was the only even prime number, so it was easy to come up with some reason why 2 was a special and unique number. And maybe it was about that time the weekend saved me. I don't really know where the weekends came. But I remember going through the entire month, scratching my head each night before I went into class, trying to find something that made the number of that particular date unique, or if not unique, at least special. We did talked about perfect numbers, we talked about Mersenne primes, we talked about triangular numbers. I remember talking about the special properties that fractions have if their denominator can be expressed totally in terms of products of 2 and 5. And sometimes before the month was over, I was really scratching my head. I remember being desperate when I got to 14. I wrote 14 on a piece of paper the night before and wrote 2 times 7 and looked at various partitions of 14, and I think I just about gave up on 14. I remember going in with something kind of weak and lame about the British weight system with 14 pounds to a stone. And of course, that makes 112 pounds to a hundredweight, which is kind of unusual, and 2,240 pounds to the ton. The students seemed rather interested, but I felt I had somehow let them down without having any mathematical property. Some of the numbers were certainly much harder than others. Some of my reasons were pretty lame. But there's a few I'd like to look at, and there's a few other numbers I want to mention too. But let's just look at the perfect numbers, because there were 2 of them that month. And the perfect numbers are the numbers like 6. And the divisors of 6, the proper divisors, if I don't include 6 itself, or 1, and 2, and 3. And those divisors add up to the number 6. And the next perfect number we encountered that month was 28. And of course its divisors are 1, and 2, and 4, and 7, and 14. I hope I haven't left any out. That looks as if it adds up to 28. And on the 7th of the month, I remember talking about Mersenne primes, if I can spell it. Perhaps it's something like that. And a Mersenne prime, and I'm kind of scribbling all over the blackboard here, but a Mersenne prime is one that is 1 less than a power of 2. And if I take that, I get the second biggest Mersenne prime. Of course,
second smallest,
right. Of course, okay. There's one that's smaller. If I
3 is a Mersenne prime, isn't it?
That's right. Okay. If I take that, I've got the smallest. And one of the interesting things about the even perfect numbers is that every one of them can be written as the product of a Mersenne prime and some other number. This one is 4 times 7, 7 is a Mersenne prime. This one is 2 times 3, and 3 is a Mersenne prime.
Okay.
And in general, all the even perfect numbers are generated by a formula that looks like this. I may have to look at it a little more carefully after I write it to make sure I've got the n and the n minus 1 in the right position. I think I should make that one the n minus 1.
Right.
So that, for instance, if n were 3, I would get 8 minus 1, which is 7, and I would get 4 times 7 is 28.
Okay, so what you're saying is that if that thing in brackets is a prime number...
That's right.
Then this formula should generate a perfect number.
That's right. Okay. If this expression in brackets is prime, and it's not always going to be prime... For instance, if n is 4, I'm going to get 15 in the brackets, and then it just generates garbage.
Okay.
But if this part in the brackets is prime, then this will generate a perfect number.
Which means that the factors at number add up
to the number itself. So the next one that we would get would be if n is 5. If n is 5, I get 2 to the 5th minus 1, which is 31. Multiply that by 2 to the 4th, which is 16, and you get the next smallest perfect number. now 31 times 16. I don't know these from memory, unfortunately, but it looks as if it's 496 is the third
perfect number. Do you want to check it out? See what adds up to it?
Well, I think I'll assume it's going to work out.
Okay.
Because there's a lot of divisors to 496.
Oh, yeah, because 31 goes into it, 62 goes in. For that matter, 124 goes in.
That's right.
Not to mention...
Well, you can tell exactly how many divisors there are, actually, because this is the 31. That's a prime number.
Yeah.
If I multiplied 5 times 2, there's 10 divisors. It wouldn't be too hard to list them all, but I'm sure if I did, they would work out.
Oh, you can sort of see why they have to work out if you think about it, because you're going to get half the number, a quarter of the number, an eighth of the number, and everything right down to 2 and 1.
That's right. Actually, looking to see why they work out, if I can just use that one as an example.
Yeah, just write them down. 248.
I could prove this in general, but let's just do it for this particular example, and you should see a pattern that would extend in general. If you look at the divisors, remember that's 31, so I've got 16 times 31. I'm going to list the divisors like this, the proper divisors. I'm going to list 1, and beside it I'm going to put 31.
Okay.
And I'm going to list 2, and beside it I'm going to put 2 times 31.
Okay.
And I'm going to list 4, and beside it I'm going to put 4 times 31.
Okay.
And I'm going to list the next one, which is 8, and beside it I'm going to put 8 times 31, and the last is 16, and beside it I'm going to put 16 times 31. Now that last one is actually the number itself.
Yeah.
So if I add up all the divisors including the number itself, I'm going to get twice the number itself.
Okay.
And here's a sneaky little way of adding it up that shows that will work. If I remember how this goes, when I add 1 and a 31, I'm going to get 1 plus 31. When I add a 2 and a 2 times 31, factor a 2 out of there, and I'm going to get 2 times 1 plus 31.
Okay.
When I do this one, I'm going to get 4 times 1 plus 31. Here I'm going to get 8 times 1 plus 31. Here I'm going to get 16 times 1 plus 31. And now, when I add those up, I'm going to add this column. I'm going to pull the 1 plus 31 out as a common factor.
Yeah.
And I'm just adding 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 8 plus 16.
Which is 31.
Which is 31.
Okay.
Is that right?
31 times 32, yeah. That's twice 31 times 16, which is what it's supposed to be.
Right, right. Yeah. And this would generalize to any number you want it, but this has got to be a...
So every Mersenne prime is going to generate a perfect number this way.
Right. Yeah, okay. But this was kind of a sidetrack that I was getting into. My real topic was interesting numbers, of which this is just one example. But how is our time coming, Marty? I never pay attention to when these breaks come. Do I have time to launch into a proof that all numbers are interesting?
Yeah, give. Unless we should do a song first.
Well, this is a short proof. I'll
do
the proof,
and
then you go into the song. This is very interesting. It's one of these kind of pseudo-mathematical proofs that I rather enjoy. I'm going to convince you and Neil that all numbers are interesting. And I'm going to do this through a proof by contradiction. And the proof is simply like this. Assume that some numbers are not interesting. Now, let's create the set of all uninteresting numbers. Now, because the numbers are well ordered, we can always put these numbers in the set in order. So from this set, let x be the smallest number. Now we have x, which is the smallest uninteresting number. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, but...
Contradiction.
Yeah.
So...
That's a pretty bad... bad proof.
It is. It's rather feeble.
Because, how interesting is the second smallest uninteresting number?
Oh, but the smallest...
when the set changes.
Oh, it's not... Yeah. If it's the second smallest uninteresting number, then it's the smallest uninteresting number by definition, since the first smallest wasn't
Okay.
I think you'd better do a song, Marty.
So what have we got, Neil? Do we have any songs?
Well, Marty, you know, we frequently... we often play fantastic songs by our contemporary creative artists, and I thought you might want to play the people a song written by one of the great hit makers of the, of yesterday.
Well, it's funny you should ask, Neil. But, you know, here's a fantastic song by Frédéric Chopin. And people who learn to play classical piano, you know, at a certain point in your life, I guess when you were a teenager, it seemed to be the common experience that people wanted to play Chopin, everything they could get by Chopin, a fantastic kind of romantic style of classical piano stuff, exemplified by this beautiful Chopin waltz, which I'm going to execute for you on TV right now. Classical music, okay. How many songs of that caliber are there? I mean, there couldn't be all that many songs that are as good as that one. But you had the hunger to find out all the ones you could. So when I was like 18 years old, I became aware of this one. I wanted to learn it, and then I bought the book. It's a Chopin waltz. And then it turns out there's a book of Chopin waltzes. So I got the book. Turns out there's a couple more in that book, almost as good as this one. The famous minute waltz, and there's a B flat waltz.